What does it mean that a person is close? It means in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person has a high rank. Has a high rank in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are they? The awliya. Who are the awliya of this ummah? First and foremost, they are the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Aqeedah talks about them. And Aqeedah also talks about those who came after them and are still coming now in our time until the end of time, who are the followers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who reach a high rank in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it also is the science of the knowledge about the a'imma. Who are the a'imma? You could translate this as the leaders of the Muslim nation. The leaders of the Muslim nation. What do we mean by the leaders? First and foremost, again, the Sahaba ikram and Duanullahi alayhim ajma'in, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was veiled from this world, the Sahaba, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, first and foremost, took the responsibility of ruling the Muslims. Yeah? So they are our leaders in the deen, and they were the leaders of the Muslim Ummah as well. Aqaid also talks about this matter, about the rulership of the Muslims, and the beliefs that are related to that. It also talks about creation and resurrection. What do you mean by that? It talks about this science of Aqeedah, talks about creation. How did things begin? Nowadays, when you go to school and colleges and universities, they tell you that everything came out of nothing. In the meaning that, their meaning is that everything came out of nothing, meaning that there was no cause for this universe. It just came about. They say to you that human beings came out of anything. No. The science of Aqeedah tells us about creation. How did creation come about? And also about resurrection. This is what we call al-ba'ath, ba'd al-maut. The Imam Mufassil, right at the end of it, we say wal-ba'ath, ba'd al-maut. This is what we mean by resurrection. And we will be brought back to life after we have died. And we will be questioned about our deeds, and the day of judgment will occur, and people will either go to Jannah or Jahannam. These matters that relate to the afterlife, being resurrected. Aqeedah talks about this as well. Now, all of this, the science of the knowledge of all these matters that we have related, that we have talked about, according to the principles of Islam. Now, we talk about all of these matters inside Aqeedah according to the principles of Islam, not the principles of the people who are philosophers or the atheists, no. We speak about all of these issues inside Aqeedah and learn the knowledge of all of these, and that knowledge is according to the principles of Islam, by which certainty is attained. That's the goal of what? Studying Aqeedah. That we gain a knowledge about all of these matters according to the principles of Islam so that we become certain. And what? Doubts are lifted. That a person has no doubt, yep, regarding these matters. That is the aim of Aqeedah, and that is the definition of Aqeedah. Long, but if you work through it, the first part is it's the science of the knowledge of, then it mentions matters that we learn about. Then it tells you that they are according to the principles of Islam. That knowledge is according to the principles of Islam. What is the aim of it? Getting certainty and removing doubt. So if we summarize that, it's the science of the knowledge of these important matters according to the principles of Islam, and by learning it, certainty is gained and doubts are lifted. Like I said, when a person has doubts, he's like that tree with weak roots, and every time the wind blows this direction, once the wind blows, he goes in that direction, and he's never firm, and one day he's just lifted out of the ground. And a building the same, when an earthquake comes and the building is shaken, and it collapses. And we give a few minutes to work through that. I'm going to run through it one more time. I'm going to rub it out, and then we're going to move forward. And we're going to, which is the bulk of this lesson, we're going to go into that, which is to define some terms that without them, a person cannot understand Aqeedah properly. And because people have not understood them, they made mistakes throughout Islamic history. People have made mistakes inside Aqeedah, and the scholars have said, this is wrong, and this is not the Aqeedah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the early generations. Why did they fall into that? It's because they didn't understand, effectively they didn't understand what they were studying to. They have not understood it properly. So, just to review this before I rub it out, Aqeedah is the original word for Aqeedah, and Aqeedah means, so Aqeedah means, in Arabic language, it means to tie in a knot, or to make a contract, a binding contract with someone, an agreement. So we can see that meaning is there inside the word aqidah in the Arabic language, that which the heart has firmly resolved upon and fastened itself to. And as a science, what is it? That science, the science of the knowledge of Allah's divine attributes and His divine actions. Attributes, we gave the example of an attribute in the meaning of strength for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to give a clear example, meaning in relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because all we did there was we took the word attribute out of that context and just looked at it as a word. What does attribute mean? We said it means meaning that is existing for something. We said examples, Ali or Adam, strong or weak. What are the attributes of Allah? Example, Allah is all seeing, Allah is all hearing. But we know that is without an eye, without an ear. Allah doesn't need an instrument, a limb. Allah is not a body. But the meaning of all being all hearing and all seeing exists for Allah. Allah has mentioned the Quran, that is As-Sami' Al-Basir. These are meanings, attributes that exist in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah is all powerful. He has the attribute Al-Qudra, divine power. Allah says in the Quran, وَهُوَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. He is all powerful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has power over all things. These are some of the divine attributes that this text, our study, will teach us about, inshaAllah ta'ala. Divine actions, like I told you, giving life, giving death, raising the rank of someone in this world and lowering others, yeah, giving some more rizq than others. These are the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah. Allah says that in the Quran that He's Muhi, that He's Mumit, He's the giver of life, He's the giver of death. These are the divine actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophets alayhi salam, this text alhamdulillah covers who were the Prophets alayhi salam that we need to know about in detail. What is a Prophet? What can we say about Prophets? What are we not allowed to say about Prophets alayhi salam? The angels, a special creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm going to mention in a moment what this text actually covers from those points. The awliya, those who have reached a high rank in worshipping of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the likes in the early generations, the Sahaba ikiram radhiyallahu ta'ala alayhim. In later times, the likes of Imam Abdul Qadir al-Jilani rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhim. These are from the awliya of this ummah, and even in our time we have awliya. And the a'imma, leaders. Who are the leaders? First and foremost, the Sahaba, the companions. What the Sahaba, the companions of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhim, radhiyallahu ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, that led the Muslim ummah. Yep. And creation and resurrection. Creation, how did everything come about? Resurrection, that we will be brought back to life. This is all according to the principles of Islam, by which certainty is attained and doubts are lifted. So the aim is to get certainty. This text that we will cover covers the divine attributes and divine actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It discusses the Prophets alayhim as-salam, and then it speaks about some of the awliya who the family of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. It covers some of the matters that relate to resurrection. It definitely covers about creation, when you speak about the attributes of Allah, that Allah existed, exists, and will forever exist, but creation was originated, so we will talk about creation. So the matters that it doesn't cover is the angels. That's covered by other books that we should read about, and perhaps in the future, if there's other courses we can go into, a text which covers, but this text primarily covers the beliefs regarding Allah, the belief regarding the Prophets alayhi wasalam, some of the matters which are related to the afterworld and the family of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasalam mentioned. And other works cover these matters, the angels. Some aqidah works cover the leadership of the ummah, how they talk about who is the best of mankind after the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasalam. This text does touch upon that right at the end. But in detail, no. In fact, this is a very brief text. That's why we've taken this text. If you understand this very well, it's a very good foundation to read other texts upon. You'll understand the words being used in other texts, the principles that are being placed. It's a very good text for a beginner. This text, by the way, at the moment, two of the students here, like this child here studied it, practically all of it. How old are you? Eight. I've previously taught it, all of the text. Children who are 8, 9, 10. They've understood it. So it's not something that's beyond us. And it's something that should be taught. These things should be taught at a young age. When the mind starts to make judgments about something being right and wrong, so that there's a good foundation for the future. This is not the only text that can be studied, no. There are other texts as well, but this is brief, that's why I chose this particular one. It's easy to understand. If we've done this, we can move forward. Because I need a bit of the board. Hopefully we haven't lost anyone. That's the worrying thing. We're going forward and we're not sure if everyone's coming with us or not. If we look, we said that we're going to study this science called Aqidah. This science that we call Aqidah has other names as well. So this is just side knowledge for us, but it's good to have. That sometimes we'll see some other books, they won't say Ilm al-Aqaid. They won't say the science of they may have another name. Examples, or which are the most common words that are used? Ilm al-Kalam. Ilm usul al-Din. We'll explain exactly why these terms have been used by the scholars. And ilm al-tawheed. Whenever I have put a line above a letter, it means stretch it. Aqa'id, ilm al-kalam, ilm usul al-deen. Ilm al-Tawheed. So these four words, they mean one thing, which is the definition that we gave before. The definition that we gave at the bottom covers all of these. Just to briefly explain what Aqeedah, you know what that means now. Bind tightly, fasten in the heart. What's Kalam? Scholars have a difference as to this science of beliefs, Aqeedah, became called Ilm al-Kalam. Some of them say because in the early generations after the Sahaba, ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, people arose that didn't follow the teachings of the companions and the teachings of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam as they were brought from generation to generation forward. They went against that and there was a lot of speech. Kalam in Arabic means speech. Meaning there was a lot of speech in these matters. People saying wrong things and people correcting them. A lot of speech went between the people. Others say that if you look at the divine attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the divine attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is divine speech. Allah says in the Quran, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. We know and we will learn that the speech of Allah is not like the speech of a human being. Allah does not have a body, not a mouth, not a tongue, and so on and so forth, that we associate with speech in terms of human beings. Allah says He spoke to Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, we accept that. It is not in the way that a human being speaks. We know that as well. One of the things which unfortunately people differed over in the early period after the time of the Sahaba, ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, was this matter, this attribute, Kalam. And therefore the entire science became known as Ilm al-Kalam, because one of the most major differed over matters where people unfortunately went the wrong way, it was this matter regarding the attribute of divine speech is called Kalam. Others have said, though, the reason that that term is used for Aqidah is because a lot of speech occurred between people over these matters in the early time. Ilm usul al-deen, this goes back to what we've been talking about. What's usul, foundations? What's deen, the deen of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What are the foundations of the religion, or the way of life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Beliefs. The roots of the tree, the foundation of the building. That's why this science deals with what? Foundation. The sciences that come out of it are called the branches. You might have heard the word in Urdu, furu'. Furu' means branches. The far of a tree is a branch of a tree. The far of a street or road is the branch that goes off the main road. Yeah? Well, in terms of deen, beliefs first, actions come out from them. That's why this science is called Usul al-Deen. The other sciences are called Furu', like Fiqh and all the other sciences that talk about how to perform wudu and the rules related to actions. Ilm al-Tawheed. Why is this science called Ilm al-Tawheed? Well, we learned in the definition that one of the matters that, in fact, the first matter that we need to know about is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His divine attributes. What does Tawheed mean? Knowing that Allah is one, affirming that as well. Knowing that Allah is one and He alone should be worshipped. Yeah? That is Tawheed. But we've learned that the science of beliefs deals with discussion about the prophets as well, about the angels as well. So why is it called Ilm al-Tawheed? It's because the most important thing that is discussed inside it is the affirmation and knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the foundation of the deen of Islam. And that is what all the prophets alayhi wa sallam have taught from the time of Sayyidina Adam alayhi wa sallam to the last and final prophet, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They all preach the same aqaid beliefs. Aqaid have never differed between prophet to prophet, impossible. Yeah. What is different is that in some of the prophets alayhi wa sallam, they were sent with different rules. Some of the messengers alayhi wa sallam, the rusul, they came with different rules related to a particular thing. So some things were allowed at the time of a prophet, and then later they were not allowed. Or they weren't allowed before, and then they were allowed. This is difference in rulings, the sharia, of each prophet. The prophets have not differed inside Islamic belief. They all preach Tawheed. What people say about Christianity and Judaism, especially children get confused. They start saying Christianity, they associate it in terms of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam from a wrong perspective, unfortunately. Christianity, Judaism was originated by people after the prophets alayhi salam had passed away, or in the case of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, after he had been raised into the heavens, for we believe that he is alive and he will return at the end of time. Christianity, Judaism are not the deen of the messengers alayhi salam. They were the corruptions of the people that came after them. All the prophets alayhi salam taught Tawheed, the aqaid of Islam. If that's clear, we're going to move forward and go to the main part in this last half an hour. We'll only be regarding just one matter. Now, if we get it right in our minds, inshallah, we'll understand all of the text of aqaid properly. This matter is so important that Imam Ghazali, rahmatullahi ta'ala, his teacher, Imam al-Haramain, the Imam of the two Harams of Makkah and Mukarramah and Madinatul Munawwara, because he was associated with them so much. Imam al-Juwayni, rahmatullahi ta'ala, the teacher of one of the great scholars of Islam, Imam al-Ghazali, rahmatullahi ta'ala. He said, whosoever does not understand this, then that person is not an intelligent person. He's not considered as an intelligent person. He's not considered as a person who's saying, really, this issue. It's not understood by a person. Technically, for us, that person is not a rational, intellectual person. I'm going to talk about that in a moment. It's fundamental intelligence that he's mentioned. It says, this thing is fundamental intelligence for every human being to know this. It's called the rational rule, or the rational judgment. First of all, what's a judgment? A hukum, a judgment. Arabic is called al-hukm al-aqli. Aqli means to do with the mind. Yep. Rational, the mind. Rational means of the mind, concerning the mind. Yep. It's called al-hukm al-aqli, the rational rule or the rational judgment. What's a hukm? What's a rule? What's a judgment? Affirming something or denying it from something else. Let's take the example again of Adam. Right now, regarding Adam, I can deny standing. the issue of standing, I can deny it. I can say Adam is not standing. There I have given a hukum judgment. I have judged that Adam standing is negated from him, denied. Adam is not standing. Yeah? But if Adam stood, I would affirm that for him. Adam is standing. That's a judgment. I have affirmed standing for Adam. In other words, I have affirmed something for something else, or denied something for something else, where the first something is standing and the second is Adam. I've affirmed for Adam standing once, and once I've denied for Adam standing. This is simply what a hukum is: affirming something or denying it for something else, from something else. What is the rational rule or judgment? Everything that the mind, that the intellect, akal, the akal, the intellect, everything that the intellect thinks about or imagines about everything that the intellect thinks about or imagines about the essences, stroke the beings, meaning that that's whichever word is more appropriate, because that word is not appropriate all the time. I'll explain that in a moment. About the essences of the beings of things or their attributes. Will be in one. Necessary, two possible, three impossible. Let's explain this. We say the judgment is to affirm something or deny it regarding something else. Now we're saying there's something called the rational judgment, al-hukm al-aqli. The rational judgment or the rational rule. What is that? Everything that the intellect, the mind, thinks about or imagines about the essences or the beings of things or their attributes will be in one of these three categories. What do we mean by the essences of beings? First, let's look at creation. We're talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this discussion right now. We are talking right now about created things. Ali has an essence, what we call a dhat in Arabic. And because of the difficulty of translating Arabic words into the English, this word has been translated by different people in different ways. And they translated verse of Akhari. Some say essence, some say being, some say self. Those words are used. Essence, being, or the self. Because the essence is beings or selves. The scholars inside the books of Aqaid actually use an example that we bring that example to understand what is an essence of a created thing. Have you seen a flower up close? Many of us should have seen a flower. Take a rose. You have the stem and you have the petals, and it has a smell and it has a color. The scholars say in that example, the dhat, the essence or the being of the flower is the stem, the leaves, the petals. Those are all what? The essence of the being. Now, the flower has a color. The flower has a smell. If you think about the flower, the smell is part and parcel of the flower. Part and parcel of it. The color is part and parcel of it. Yet at the same time, you won't say it is the flower. But at the same time, you can't deny that it isn't the flower. You've got the stem, the leaves, and you've got the smell and the color that make up that flower. Yeah? It's a creative thing that we're talking about, remember? The stem, the leaves, the petals, the essence of the being, the actual flower itself. I think there's some meanings there as well. What are the meaning of the smell? The meaning of the color that's associated with it, the size, the weight of it, all of these things. You can't say they're not the flower, yet you can't say they are the flower itself. Yep. Rather, the meaning is established with it, but you can't say that they're not. This is an example of a creative thing. Definitely, when we speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we cannot make any comparison. That should be remembered throughout Aqai. We can never make a comparison for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for He, there is nothing like Him. Laysa kamithlihi shay. There is nothing like unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why have the scholars struck this example? Is to explain the word only, essence and being, in relation to creativity, and attributes. I said an attribute is a meaning that exists with the existence of a thing, like weight, size, strength, power. With the flower, it would be color as well. Yeah, because it's a creative thing, you say, its color, its smell. Yeah? These are the attributes of the flower. And the vaab, the essence of the flower itself. So Ali is strong. Think about that. Ali is strong. It's a judgment. Being strong is a meaning in Ali that is associated with Ali, that exists with Ali. It's not Ali himself. Yeah? It's not Ali himself. And at the same time, you can't say that it's not Ali. Yeah? This is creative things, right? Know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not comparable to creation. Creation cannot be compared to Allah. Allah cannot be created compared to creation. Allah exists, the dhat of Allah, and the sifat, what we call the attributes. You've probably heard this word before, scholars have mentioned, or inside the speeches of the Imams. The dhat of Allah, the essence, the being, the self of Allah, is not like the existence of anything else. Incomparable. And the attributes of Allah are not like the attributes of anything else. Allah exists, we are told not to think about and to ponder over the dhat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can never, ever think that we could encompass the understanding of the existence of Allah. We can't even comprehend ourselves properly. And we're created beings. We can't comprehend and totally understand that which is in the created existence. And Allah is uncreated. Allah exists and He has divine attributes. He's all-seeing, He's all-hearing, He's all-powerful. These are attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has divine will. He has divine knowledge. These are the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't have a beginning. He doesn't have an end. These are the divine attributes of Allah. Allah exists and has divine attributes. If that's clear, we can say that everything that the intellect thinks about or imagines about the essences of beings of things or their attributes will be in one of three categories. While knowing that the word essence of being and attribute, when you think of human beings, or created things, can't be compared with the meaning when you are talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That should be very clear. No comparison. Yeah. The words may be the same. Sifat, attributes of a human being, it is sifat as well. And in relation to Allah, it's mentioned sifat or sifat. That, the existence of Allah, the being of Allah. That's why people run away from this word essence. Sometimes when the word essence is used, it conjures up this kind of thing which is physical. Like if you have a spray and you spray, you say that's the essence of it. It's a bukhur burning. You say, oh, the essence of it is a smoke. That is why people run away from that, because they don't want to create the impression that they are saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a body, astaghfirullah. So some people, they prefer to use being, the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, if we then look at this statement is saying that when the human mind, the intellect thinks about, imagines about the essence of beings of anything, of or thinks about the attributes, that thinking will be in one of these three categories. When they think about those, they will conclude without one of these three categories for those things. And to give you an example, so that you can understand each one, there are only three categories. There is no fourth. There is no fourth. Everything will either be necessary, possible, or impossible. There is no fourth. One of the examples that ulama give is that if you look at created things, bodies, yeah, created things, bodies are either in movement or they are still. There is no other option. A body is either moving or still. When you mean body, it doesn't mean just a human body. This is a body, substance, yeah, physicality it has. It's a body. This has a body. This is a body. Know that Allah is not a body. So these are bodies. Yeah? These are either in movement or stillness. Yeah? For a body to be either moving or still, it's necessary. It's necessary that either a body is moving or still. Yeah? So we can give an example. Example. Or still. Taking the same example, it is possible for a body to be still, and it's possible also that a body to be moving. Make it clearer. For a body to be one of either moving or still, for a body to be one of either moving or still is necessary. Either the thing is moving or is still. It can't say it's moving and still. If there's movement inside, it's moving. It doesn't matter how small the movement is, it's moving. If it's still, it's still. Yep. For, it's necessary that a body either to be one of either moving or still. It must be having the attribute of moving or the attribute of still. It must be having one of those attributes. You can't say it doesn't have that or that. You can't say this thing, body, is neither moving or still. No, it's necessary. This is the nature of bodies. This is an attribute of bodies. They are either moving or still. One of the two. This is still, the car is moving, and the car will stop, it will be stationary. Taking the same example, if we say in terms of a body that X, a particular body, is still or moving, equal possibilities for it. Take a particular body, yeah, like a car. At a particular moment in time, it is possible for it to be still and it's